Harper Audio presents Eyes Wide Open, How to Make Smart Decisions in a Confusing World by Noreena Hertz. Read by the author.
This decision will change your life. Step 1. Get to grips with a world in hyperdrive. It's Monday morning. In Washington, the President of the United States is sitting in the Oval Office assessing whether or not to order a military strike on Iran. In Idaho, Warren Buffett is deciding whether to sell his Coca-Cola shares or buy more. In Madrid, Maria Gonzalez's mother is trying to work out whether to let her baby continue crying until he falls asleep or pick him up and soothe him. I am sitting by my father's bedside in hospital, trying to decide whether I should let the doctor operate or wait another 24 hours. We face momentous decisions with important consequences throughout our lives, difficult and challenging problems that we are given sole responsibility to solve. On top of this, we have to make up to 10,000 trivial decisions every single day, 227 just about food. Caffeinated or decaf, small, medium, large or extra large, Colombian, Ecuadorian, Ethiopian, hazelnut, vanilla or unflavoured, cream or milk, brown sugar or sweetener. If you make the wrong choice when it comes to your coffee, it doesn't matter very much. You make a face and move on. But make the wrong choice when it comes to your finances, your health or your work, and you could end up sicker or poorer or lose your job. And if your decisions relate to others, your parents, your children, your country, or your staff, the choices you make can irreversibly impact the direction their lives will take too, not only today, but in the months and years ahead. Errors in decision-making lead young people to undersave for retirement, doctors to miss tumours, CEOs to make catastrophic investments, governments to engage in needless wars, and parents to irreversibly traumatize their children. This book is about how to make better choices and smarter decisions when the stakes are high and the outcome really matters, whether you're a politician, a business person, a professional, or a parent. Think yourself smarter. It's actually very surprising how little we think about the quality of our decision-making and how we could improve it. How absent decision-making classes are from educational curricula. How little we think about how it is we think. Ask most people why they came to a certain decision and watch them stumble. How we come to our own assessments, how we arrive at our predictions and choices are things we seldom scrutinise. For the sake of our health, our wealth and our future security, we must take it upon ourselves to challenge the way we make our decisions. It's a matter of self-empowerment. If we do not want to be victims of a future that others dictate to us, we need to get better at making choices with our eyes wide open, our brains switched on. This means getting better at collecting, filtering, and processing information, getting smarter at establishing who to trust and whose recommendations to take on board, getting more adept at analysing different options and weighing up divergent opinions. It also demands that we forge a clearer sense of how it is we come to make decisions, that we understand how our emotions, feelings, moods and memories affect our choices, and that we better know and understand our environment so that we can master its particular challenges as well. More specifically, we need to come to terms with three powerful ways in which the environment we now live in can inhibit our ability to think smartly and choose wisely. Drowning in the deluge. For this is the age of data deluge, an age in which advertisers, marketers, and media outlets tweet us, text us, and follow us online. An age of Facebook news feeds and Amazon recommends. An age in which we are overwhelmed with information, increasingly to breaking point. A New York Times weekly edition contains more information than the average person in the 17th century was likely to come across in their entire lifetime. In 2008, we were consuming three times as much information as we were in 1960. By 2020, we'll be generating 44 times more data than we are producing today. Our Stone Age bodies can't cope with this modern-day deluge. Evolution is slow. The deluge has come fast. Confronted with data, some dodgy, some not, our hearts beat faster. Our breath becomes more shallow. We sweat. The deluge makes our body shift into crisis mode. Studies reveal that we can't hold more than 7 separate pieces of information in our minds at once. Yet when I enter qualities to look for in a surgeon into Google, 4 million hits come up. The sheer abundance overwhelms us. That's why most of us end up looking at just the first few links on the first page of Google's search results. The best answer to our query might not be there, but we can't cope with more. How can we find the space to think clearly with all of this data raining down on us? How can we discern intelligence from all this noise? For there is intelligence amidst the cacophony. In fact, the data deluge has a notable upside. We can now get our information raw, unedited, uncurated. We can now imbibe information direct from source without the traditional gatekeepers. This offers a huge opportunity to us as decision makers. But the question of what, among all the data swirling around the digital landscape, we should give credence to is not straightforward to answer. In London, in August 2011, huge numbers of people rioted and parts of the city went up in flames. Shops were emptied of expensive trainers and widescreen TVs. The police looked on powerlessly. It wasn't that there was no information. Tuned into social media, police command centres were overwhelmed by the 2.6 million riot-related tweets that circulated during the 5 days of rioting. The tales circulating the Twittersphere were plentiful and varied, from the political to something more akin to a child's picture book, rioters breaking into a branch of McDonald's to cook their own food, the London Eye being set on fire, a tiger being set free from London Zoo. The problem was, in the face of so much information, how could the police work out which stories to trust and which to reject? Which leads should manpower be assigned to investigate? Which should be ignored? All of those tweets just mentioned turned out to be false, by the way. In the age of data deluge, with information so fractured and diffuse and arising from so many disparate sources, how do we know what to believe and what to reject so we are able to benefit from the digital dividend? That is a challenge that this book will address. Drip, drip, drip. Ping, ding, ring. Add to the barrage of data another 21st century form of Chinese water torture, the drip, drip, drip of continuous disruption, and you'll be able to better understand the demanding context within which we make our decisions. In this regard, email is mental enemy number one. The constant pinging, window signalling or green light blinking depending which medium it finds you on. Some saw it coming, saw the inherent problem of a medium which could so easily get out of control. In 1984, just as email was beginning to enter the mainstream, Jakob Palmer, a computer scientist from the QZ Computer Centre at the University of Stockholm, with a sideline in writing crime novels, warned that electronic mail system, if used by many people, causes severe information overload problems. The cause of this problem, Palmer wrote, is that it is so easy to send a message to a large number of people, and that systems are often designed to give the sender too much control of the communication process and the receiver too little control. In the future, when we get larger and larger message systems, and these systems get more and more interconnected, this will be a problem for almost all users of these systems. And so it was that Palmer's prophecy came to be. This is an age of CC and BCC. With the click of a mouse, you can send an email to everyone you know. Time and time again, we find ourselves giving people information they really don't need. In 2012, more than 204 million emails were sent every minute of every day. How many emails do you receive each day? What are all these messages doing to your ability to concentrate, to think, to plan, to decide? And that's just emails. Add to this the constant droning background noise of open-plan offices, the rat-a-tat-tat of mobile phones, texts, instant messages, Skype calls, phone calls, the lure of websites demanding your attention, and you'll start to get the picture. These days, we spend 3/4 of our waking lives receiving information. Henry Kissinger built a soundproof office above his garage in which to work, banning his wife 4 children from entering while he was thinking. But most of us can't physically absent ourselves when we've got decisions to make. Instead, we have to operate in a state of nothing less than continuous and relentless interruption. On average, computer users change windows and check email or another program 37 times an hour. 43% of college students say they are interrupted by social media 3 or more times an hour when they are working. And when someone's trying to reach us nowadays, not only will they email us, they'll text us, tweet us, phone and voicemail us too. Often it can feel that there is no escape. The relentlessness of this bombardment has an impact. A Microsoft research study which tracked over 2,000 hours of employee computer activity found that once distracted by an email alert, computer users take an average of 22 minutes to return to the suspended task with the same level of focus. In 27% of cases, it took them more than 2 hours to return to the task they were doing in the first place. More recent studies have revealed that tasks take a third longer when interrupted by email. Whilst a study of employees at the communications firm, Porto Novelli, suggested that the combined effect of incessant phone calls and emails can lead to a temporary drop in our IQ of an extraordinary and disturbing 10 points. As for open plan offices, the constant background buzz of other colleagues and office equipment makes us 66% less productive. Phones ringing on desks, the background hum of conversations we are not part of, and the chime of emails arriving in our inbox distract and demotivate us at work. The drip, drip, drip doesn't just make us less able to think, it's also exhausting us. We are spent, unable to sleep, headaches ever looming, always tired. Our bodies cope with these new demands by keeping us, as we will learn, in a constant state of hormone-induced stress. Yet we crave these interruptions like catnip. Despite their pernicious impact, we actively seek them out. 40% of people continue to check their work email after hours or while they are on holiday. 86% of us use our mobiles while watching TV. This figure rises to 92% for the 13 to 24 age group. An informal poll of friends reveals a geneticist who checks news sites every 5 minutes while at work, a TV executive who catches up on his emails while on the phone while he's on the stationary bike at the gym, an art dealer who logs onto the Daily Mail website 60 times a day. We are addicted, stressed, and overwhelmed. And it's often while we are in this state that big as well as small decisions have to be made. Whether we can be switched on, if we remain switched on, is a question I will return to. The age of disorder. Alongside the constant distraction and the drip, drip, drip of the deluge, the third defining characteristic of our times, the triple of the triple whammy, is disorder. A combination of the breakdown of old established orders and the extremely unpredictable nature of our age. For this is an age in which accepted wisdoms have been dramatically overturned. An age in which Lehman Brothers, a bank that was too big to fail, proved to be expendable. A time when rather than preventing women from getting sick, it turns out that regular screening for breast cancer may actually make them sicker. An era when certainties can no longer be presumed certain. Who would have thought 10 years ago that serious conversations would be taking place about the Chinese yuan replacing the US dollar as the world's main reserve currency, that a Eurozone country, Cyprus, would impose draconian capital controls, or that closer to home, we might no longer be able to trust in the safety of investing in bricks and mortar. Things we thought we could rely upon now seem ever more vulnerable and chimerical. Moreover, those who we depended upon to translate and curate the old world order for us, have, in just a few years, lost their monopoly of knowledge. Librarians are being usurped.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.